live. I am live. So, yeah, why don't you go someplace else where you can be on your phone and you can chat with me? Because this is the time when we wait for people to show up.
Well, you're going to have these 15 minutes recorded.
I know.
So,
That's.
when you want to.
Yeah. That's how I want to do that. And I look dark that way. Let me see. All right. The nature of the beast. So, good morning to those of you who are walking by. Good morning of those to you who aren't walking by. Service will be starting at 10:45. Just here hanging out, waiting to welcome in whoever it is that comes in. Jose, it would be nice if you were standing next to me passing out bulletins, but those days are gone for another couple of weeks or so it appears. So just hanging out, watching the screen scroll behind me. Not much going on, but it's a beautiful Sunday morning. For those of you who aren't in the area here, it is 70 some degrees outside. It will hit 80 by the time that we're done. The sky is blue, a little breeze going on, birds flying around out there through the palm trees. It's a beautiful day in the Naples, Florida neighborhood. Hope it's a beautiful day in your neighborhood, wherever that happens to be. So this is a whole new deal. Have no idea how this is going to work, but I hope that it does. I can continue jabbering on, and I think I will until I see that people join me, in which case I'll say hello. Thought maybe by now, Gail would be on, but she hasn't got herself settled yet. That's all right. Look forward to seeing all the people that will come on. The live message is flashing at me. I have no idea what that means. There's Gail. Hello, Gail. Can you see me? Can you hear me? Can you write me a message? Can you tell me why my live button is kind of going in and out? I guess that one up there either means this is one video or one person is viewing me. Gail McLaren just joined. And Gail, can you write a comment? See, somebody's trying to do something. Hi, Jim. I don't know one person. Okay, very good. It's an have one. Okay, there's whoop. Oh, come on. Okay. I am fussing. I can see that I got one person, but from the view that I got here, I can't see what the comments are. I have to expand my view. And that can work for a while, I think. My audio keeps breaking up. Does my audio keep breaking up because I was fooling around, or does my audio keep breaking up? I know you're on tape delay. So I talk and then I stop. So this is like any other Sunday morning. You sit here and you wait and you watch for somebody to come in. Okay, I suspect my audio breaking up was more a result of what I was doing than what the audio was doing. Yeah. So something pinged somewhere, probably a email notification. So we'll see, we got 10:37. So what that's 13 minutes to go, 8 minutes to go. 10:40 would be 5 plus 2, 7 minutes to go. All right, so that, yeah, this is like a Sunday morning. We should have a Sunday morning-like prayer. Father, please help us with the service and with this technical stuff. Please make it work. Fussing around with stuff behind me. All right. Please make it work. So, how is it up there? Out there. Hey, Patty Lindstrom just joined. Hi, Patty. How is it in Ohio? Oh, we got somebody else that just joined. Don't see who they are yet. Larry came. Larry's got a message. Send message to Larry. Telling Larry go to PARADISE, Paradise Coast Church. Facebook, and I'm there. All right. Hopefully, we get Larry on board. And we'll see who else joins us. So, Patty, can you write me a comment about how life is in Ohio? Is it snowing there this morning? And we've got 10:40, another 5 minutes till we start, or something like that. And I expect to see Larry Kane join us in a moment. So it's a beautiful day in the neighborhood here. It's in the upper 70s, blue skies, little breeze, birds flying around outside. Oh, okay. The Lindstroms are all gathered. I see the message now. Thank you. 40 and sunny. Great. I've got a third person, but I don't see who it is yet. That's all right. I'm sure that will come up in a moment. 10:42, and we'll be starting in 3 or 4 minutes or so. So new behaviors are hard to learn. So we'll see how hard it is to learn this new behavior. So our two went back, or our three went back down to two, so whoever it was didn't really get on. That's all right. So it's Sunday, another day that the Lord has made, another opportunity for us to gather to worship. 10:43, counting down to 10:45. Just like a live worship service. People don't show until it's exactly time. And I suspect if it's like a typical Sunday, we won't know until 5 to 10 minutes into the service who all is going to be here. Okay, good morning to the next person who joined. Glad that you're here. Hope that you will Stick around and see what's going to happen. 10:44. And 1 minute until we officially begin. So we'll see what's going on there. Oh, somebody likes it. I see that little heart. Very nice. Hi, Bruce. Todd has been sending, well, has been recording old Christian music. Oh, okay, to send to you. Well, that's great. I appreciate that. There is somebody else that's come on. All right, very good. Bruce Montgomery and Mike Miller. So I got comments. Yeah, so welcome to YouTube. And we'll see who else comes on. It's 10:45. That means it's nearly time to begin. We'll give another moment for those who are traveling and have been held up in traffic, online traffic or real-time traffic. I know. Okay, got 10:46. Let's get this rolling. So I want to say welcome to Paradise Coast Church. Yay! Glad that you're here. Jesus tells us that wherever two or three are gathered together in his name, there he is in the midst of them, and so here he is in the midst of us. Now, I know how that works on a typical Sunday morning. We all gather in one place, and we're together, and we see each other, and we feel God's presence in the house with us. But online, I'm not sure how all that works, but we are gathered here online in his name, more than a couple of us. So somehow, some way, he is here with us at work through all the circuitry of the computers and the mysteries of the internet. So we're going to pray and say hello. Our Father, we are thank you for this opportunity to gather in worship in this way in which we're not accustomed to. We thank you for your presence with us, and we ask for your help throughout the service this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so I want to start us off with a psalm. I'd like to read to us from Psalm 23. Psalm 23. There it is. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely your goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Strange times we're in. The coronavirus and all that, and with all the things that are going on, the Lord is still our shepherd. God is still watching over us. God is still taking care of us. God is still in control. One of the things that I've noticed watching the news is that there is lots of faith and confidence in the American economic system, lots of faith and confidence in American ingenuity. Lots of faith and confidence in all the things that we've got through in the past. And we are convinced because of all of these resources and all of these things that we got through in the past, we will get through this as well. All that may be so, but the key factor as to whether or not we get through and how we get through is not the accumulated stockpiles, our ability to mobilize people, researchers and developers. No, what will get us through is God. It's God that gets us through. And so we are gathered here this morning to do what we as a church can do best, and that is to pray. And the scientists are going to be busy researching and playing and all the stuff that they have on their tables in front of them. Doctors are going to be busy doing all the doctor stuff. Politicians are going to be busy doing all the political stuff to try to make things happen. But we as a church need to be busy praying. And we're going to do that in a moment. We're going to do that in a moment. Okay. I'm trying to get my slide to move. There it is. Do that in a moment. I would like to receive prayer requests. So if you have any prayer requests this morning as we go to pray, and see them, and we'll share them with you. We don't have any music today because that is beyond my technical capacity to get music to us. Anyone watching that knows how to do that or to help me with this broadcast in any way, I am open to your help because we'll probably be doing this for another week or two or something. So let me scroll down here through the comments. Okay, there's Mike and Brian and Mike and oh, hey, it's working. Thank you, Brian. Mike Stolke, it's working. Okay, great. Hi, Jose. Can I turn up my end? Well, let me see if I can. I can turn it up a little bit, so I need to talk louder. Oh, Lizette, very good. Good to see you. Oh, Jan Kane. Okay, there's Jose. Any prayer requests? Any prayer requests? Oh, Jan and Strat are watching. Hello, Jan and Strat. Prayer request. I'm going to wait just a moment for a prayer request. And if none come up, I will pray. And if I got prayer requests, we will pray for those as well. I'd like to share about our friend Thomas, who went to the emergency room earlier this week, was tested, does not have the virus, has the flu. He's home, he's recovering, nearly recovered from it, but he's kind of stuck inside for a while, more so than the rest of us. So we want to pray for Thomas. Any other prayer requests out there? Okay, I hear none, and I see none. Well, wait a minute, let me scroll down here some more. Okay, there's Jenny and Nick. Volume's fine, turn up on your end. Okay, Brian, the pandemic be used to turn the nation to God. There's a prayer request. We'll be praying that. Pray for interest rates to go down for home purchase. So Jose's looking at buying a home. Good. Other prayer requests coming in. We'll give it another moment. This is kind of cool. I'm glad you're out there and letting me know. Other prayer requests. Another moment. Okay, I think we got something. Yeah, for Thomas Probin to fully recover from the flu. Yeah, we got that. Thank you, Mike. Another moment. Okay, we're going to pray in 3, 2, 1. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be gathered together this morning. We thank you for the miracle of internet and online technology that allows us to connect. And we thank you, Father, that you are the shepherd. You are the one who is in charge. You are the one who watches over us. You are the one who protects us. You are the one who leads us. You are the one who guides us. You are the one who is at work in our hearts. And Father, we offer ourselves up to you in this time of uncertainty. We see the virus that has been spreading. We also see good news that there are medicines that can address it and slow it down and stop it. And Father, we are all practicing social distancing because we're told that if we stay apart from one another, we can stop this thing from spreading. And we ask, Father, that you would bless those efforts to keep us apart and stop this thing from spreading. We ask, Father, that you would be with our doctors and our researchers and that you would help them to find treatments that work to bring healing to this. We ask that you would identify healing agents that lots of people can have access to those healing medicines. And we know, Father, that beyond the medicines and the research that you heal through prayer. And so we pray, Father, for the people all over the world who have this. We ask that you would bring healing. We ask that you would bring recovery. We ask that you would stop this virus in its tracks. We ask that you would bring it to an end. We ask, Father, that within the next week, 2 weeks, that you would return things to normal. We thank you for the hard work and the sacrifice of so many people to keep us safe. We pray for the president and for his advisors and teams that are working on this. We ask that you would give them leadership and guidance. We ask that you would open their ears to the ability to hear from you and that you would give them the courage to go to the in the directions that you lead them. We pray for the Senate and for the House of Representatives. We ask that you would help them to be able to work together to bring about whatever assistance it is they can to all of us who are watching and waiting to see what they will do. We ask, Father, that you would help people put down political rivalries and political ambitions and to work together to serve the country. Father, we pray for the rest of the world and for the leaders in those countries, for we are seeing now through this pandemic that we are connected far more closely than we think about. We pray, Father, for Mexico as things haven't really hit there yet, and it appears that they're not ready for it. We ask that you would help them to prepare for it, and in helping them to prepare for it, that you would keep them safe and us safe as well. Father, we pray for the people in China as they deal with it, and we thank you that things look like they're clearing up in China, and we ask that you would cause that trend to continue. We pray for Italy, who seems to be in the midst of a terrible infestation of this thing. Please help them. Please help them. Please clear it up there. And Father, we ask that you would be with us as we watch and as we wait. Please keep our eyes open to see you, to watch for what it is you're doing. And we ask that you would use this pandemic to turn people to you. We ask that you would use this pandemic to start a mighty move of your spirit across this land and around the world. There are so many people, Father, who are far from you. And there are so many people, Father, who would like to know you, but don't know how, don't know where to look. And during this time, as people turn to you, I ask that they would be able to find you. And even in the midst of social distancing, I ask that you would use each of us, wherever it is we are, to be used by you to help others around us to connect with you. Father, we pray for Thomas and we ask that you would bring him recovery from the flu. We pray for Jose as he's looking at buying a house, and we ask that interest rates would fall, not only for him, but for all the people who are looking at making purchases. And we pray, Father, for the economy. We pray for people around us who are out of work, who have lost jobs right now. We ask that you would take care of them, and that you would provide for them, and that you would make it possible for them to return to their jobs very soon. As our service continues, Father, we ask that you would open our ears that we might hear, our minds that we might understand, and our hearts that we might receive all that you have for us this day. In the wonderful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Let me scroll down and check some of the comments before I move on. Okay, lots of people saying hello. That's cool. Joseph, all right. Yeah, Mike says we prayed for Naples and Irma, and the Lord helped us, and He'll help us. He'll help us here too. Okay, I need to change gears just a moment here. Let's see if this works. See if this works. There it is. All right. I'm going to try and do something that resembles a message. We'll see if I'm any more successful this week than I am when I'm live and in person in front of you. At Paradise Coast Church, we have been counting down to Easter. Yay! Three more Sundays. So in our Easter countdown, we have seen that Jesus ended up on the cross not because he was a victim. Jesus was not the victim of the plot of some religious leaders who were trying to get him out of their hair. No, he's not a victim. Jesus chose to go to the cross. He is there because he wanted to be there. He is there because he made it happen. He initiated it. So the question is, why would Jesus, the Son of the living God, choose to go through the most humiliating and painful execution that humans have ever devised? What we've been learning is that Jesus chose because on the cross a great transfusion took place. All the junk that's in us, all the sin, all of the toxic waste, all of the guilt, all the shame, all the regret, all of that was pumped out of us when Jesus went to the cross. And as he's on the cross, it's being pumped into him. In 2 Corinthians 5, we're told God made him who had no sin for us. All the junk that was in us was pumped into him so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So as all the junk is pumped into him, all the goodness, all the beauty, all the righteousness that is in his heart is being pumped out into us. Jesus went to the cross for that transfusion to happen. Jesus went to the cross so that God's address could change. In the past, God lived in a temple. In a building, he lived in a tent, but he didn't like those arrangements. God wants to be nearer to us than a building. God wants, in fact, to be nearer to us than we are to ourselves. So Jesus went to the cross to remove the barriers that exist between us and God so that God could be nearer to us than we are to ourselves. As Jesus died on the cross, removing the barriers, he made it possible for God's Holy Spirit to come and dwell within us. So God no longer lives in a temple or someplace way out there, but God has moved his dwelling among us and within us through his Holy Spirit. Jesus chose the cross because in his death on the cross, he was able to establish his kingdom in our lives and use us to spread that kingdom to the lives of other people. All that happened because he went to the cross, but there is more. There is more. So for today, I want to start here. Have you ever felt like you didn't belong? Have you ever felt like an outsider? Have you ever felt like you don't measure up? Have you ever felt like no matter how hard you try, you will never get invited to sit at the cool kids' table? You ever felt that way? Yeah, me too. Truth be told, even the kids sitting at the cool kids' table feel that way. They feel like outsiders. They feel like they don't belong. They feel like they don't measure up. And they are surprised that they are at the cool kids' table. And in addition to those things, they have this giant fear going on. They don't believe they should be at the cool kids' table because all that stuff that they feel. And they are afraid that someone is going to expose them as an outsider, as someone who doesn't belong, as someone who doesn't measure up. And they're scared to death for that to happen because they don't want to be booted off the cool kids' table. So the defense mechanism is to point out the uncoolness and the ways in which everybody else doesn't measure up so that everybody's looking at everybody else and nobody's looking at them to notice that they don't belong either. Well, what's going on? And what does this have to do with why Jesus would choose to go to the cross? Well, what's going on has been going on for a long time. There's the cool kids table. It's been going on since the very beginning, since Genesis. In fact, we start to read about it in Genesis chapter 3. Long before there was a cool kids table, there was only one table. It was a God's table. And everybody was invited to God's table, and everybody was Adam and Eve. And every day they would join God in the cool of the garden, walking and talking with God. And in walking and talking with God in the cool of the garden, they were naked and unashamed. They were naked. They had nothing to hide from each other or from God. They weren't ashamed. They had no sense of guilt. They had no fear of punishment. Everything was great between they and God and each other. One day, however, Eve took a piece of fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the tree that God had told them not to eat from. She took a bite. She handed it to Adam. He took a bite. What happened was that they felt naked and ashamed. The serpent told them that they would be like God, but he lied. They weren't like God. They realized that they were naked and ashamed. Naked meant they had something to hide from each other, something to hide from God. And they were ashamed. Because they had something to hide, they were now convinced that God couldn't love them, and they felt like they deserved judgment, condemnation, punishment, and judgment for what they had just done. And that they could never, ever be invited back to God's table. And the other thing that was going on was that they didn't trust each other anymore because their hope was that God wouldn't find out. They could hide their shame, they could hide what they did, God wouldn't find out, and they could pretend like it was all along, unless one ratted out the other. And they weren't at all sure that they could trust each other anymore, not to rat each other out. So to remedy this whole situation, they covered themselves with fig leaves, because the fig leaves would hide the nakedness, would hide what it is that it is I have to hide, would hide the shame. So that evening, in the cool of the garden, God comes to walk and talk in the garden with them. He doesn't see them. So he calls out, "Adam, where are you?" Adam responds, "I'm hiding." God says, "Why are you hiding?" Adam says, "I'm naked." God says, "Who told you were naked? Did you eat from the tree that I told you not to eat from?" And at that moment, Adam knows that he's busted. And he knows that both he and Eve are toast because if God knows he ate, he knows that she ate. And now they can never be loved, They can never be accepted. They can never belong. They deserve judgment, condemnation, punishment, banishment. It's all over. Or is it? Adam sees one solution to this, and that is to make God believe that as miserable as Adam is in the midst of all this, he's not as miserable as Eve. As bad as Adam is, as bad as Adam is messed up, he hasn't messed up as badly as Eve. So if God has to choose between one or the other of them, then certainly God would choose the one that is messed up the least. So Adam raises up a standard and he says to God, yeah, it was the woman that you gave me. He spread a little blame to God. It was her fault. And Adam threw her under the bus saying, yeah, I messed up, but I didn't mess up as badly as she did, because she's the one that started it. So she's more guilty than I am. God turned to Eve. Eve, what have you done? And Eve threw the serpent under the bus. And we've been throwing each under the bus ever since. Cain threw Abel under the bus. And as you read the stories throughout the rest of the Old Testament, everybody gets thrown under the bus. And the dynamic is all the same. We have stuff in our lives that we try to hide. Things that we've done that we wish that we hadn't done. Things that we've said that we wish that we hadn't said. And we are convinced that as a result of those things, we aren't lovable, that God doesn't love us, that God never will love us, that we aren't acceptable, and that we deserve judgment, condemnation, punishment, and banishment. And our only hope in the midst of all this is to raise up some kind of standard so that I can say, I may have screwed up in all of these areas in my life, but this one thing I've done right. And because you haven't done this one thing right, like I've done this one thing right, you can't possibly be as acceptable to God as I am, even in my unacceptable state. The Israelites used a law to do this. They said to all the nations of the world, as messed up as we are, we're not as messed up as you are because God gave us the law. Therefore, we are God's favorites. And the rest of you are all toast. And the other peoples of the world said to the Israelites, who cares about your God? We have our own gods and we're quite happy to worship them. And besides, our gods are better than your gods because we have conquered you. So go home, pay your taxes, and be quiet. And today there are all kinds of tables, all kinds of people around the table clinging to one standard, saying to everyone else, you can't sit at our table because you haven't met this standard. Oh yeah, we've screwed up in all kinds of other ways, but we've kept this one standard. So there's the cool kids table. We're cooler than you are. There's the band table. Musically talented with our instruments. There's the choir table. We're musically talented with our voices. There's the football players table. We're athletically talented for football. There's the basketball players table. We're athletically talented for basketball. There's the nerd table. There's the computer table. There's the geek table. There's the rich kids table. There's the poor kid. All kinds of tables. And everybody at every table is saying, yeah, I'm messed up, but I'm not as messed up as all you at the other tables because I have done this one thing. And therefore, God has to, like me, better than you, as bad as I am. And as bad as I am, I'm not as messed up as you because of this one thing that I've managed to pull off. That's what's been going on. What does this have to do with Jesus choosing to die on the cross? Jesus chose to die on the cross to end all of this. Jesus chose to die on the cross to bring us all back to one table. Well, how does his death on the cross accomplish that? Paul talks about it in the letter to the Ephesians, chapter 2. We're going to be working verses 12, quite a ways down through that. I'm going to have it on the screen here behind me. I'm going to have it on the screen here behind me as best I can. Let's see, can we get it? There it is. I'm going to have it on the screen here behind me. Maybe you can read that, maybe you can't, but turn in your own Bibles and you can follow along with me, and we're going to walk down through these passages and see how it is that Jesus' death on the cross addresses this problem of a whole bunch of tables and everybody at every table saying, I'm better than all of you, and everybody in competition with everybody for the status of God's favorite and the desperate hope that maybe because we do this one thing right, we can get invited to God's table. Okay, so here we go. In Ephesians 2, chapter 12, we start the passage off with, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship to Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. Remember, Paul says, when you were an outsider, when you didn't belong, when you didn't measure up, when you had no hope of ever measuring up. Remember that? Okay, you remember? All right, here we go. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. You didn't belong, now you belong. You were an outsider, you're not an outsider anymore. You're an insider. You didn't measure up. Oh, you don't have to worry about that anymore. You've been invited to the table. And all this happened through the blood of Jesus, through Jesus dying on the cross. How does his death on the cross cause that to happen? Continue on to the next verse. For Jesus himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one, all the people at all the tables one, and has destroyed the barriers, the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. So somehow Jesus on the cross destroyed the barriers, the hostility, and the standards that we use to differentiate ourselves from each other. So somehow on the cross, Jesus made it possible for the stuff that I have done, for which I feel guilt, the stuff that I have done for which I feel regret, the stuff that I have done that I want to hide, the stuff that I have done that causes me not to measure up. Somehow Jesus has taken care of that, and somehow Jesus has removed us from having to face judgment, condemnation, punishment, and banishment. And further, the way Jesus has removed that from us has nothing to do with these standards that we try to hold ourselves and each other to. Has nothing to do with the law in terms of the Ten Commandments, and has nothing to do with, well, I'm cool and you're not. Or I can play the trumpet and you can't. Or I can do all kinds of cool stuff on the computer and you can't. Therefore, God must like. It has nothing to do with that. Jesus has destroyed all that. He has taken it all away. He has abolished it all. There is now a new way to relate to God, to ourselves, and to each other. And somehow or another, this has come through his death on the cross. Somehow or another, he has pulled this off in his flesh as he died on the cross. So let's see if we can figure out how that is. Next verse. Jesus' purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace in one body, reconciling them both of God, reconciling both of them to God through the cross by which he put to death their hostility. So it's the cross that brings about the reconciliation, it brings about the death of hostility. And the way the cross does this, as we saw a couple of weeks ago, it's laid out in Isaiah 53. You can read the whole chapter. It talks about this. But 53 verse 5 really summarizes it for us. Jesus, when he's dying on the cross, but he, Jesus, was pierced for our transgressions. He's on the cross for the things that we have done. He was crushed for our iniquities. He's on the cross for what it is he's done. And the punishment that we deserved, The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. Jesus died on the cross to pay for, all the things that I have done that I wish that I could undo. He died on the cross to pay for all the words that I have said that I wish that I could go back and unsay. Jesus died on the cross for all those things that I didn't do that I desperately now wish that I had done. Jesus died on the cross to pay for those words that I wish that I had said, but never managed to get the words out. He paid for all of that. He paid the price. You see, we're right in assuming that as a result of these things, we should be judged. He takes the judgment. And we're right that as a result of all these things that we have done, we should be condemned. On the cross, he takes the condemnation. And we're right that as a result of all these things, we should be punished. And on the cross, he takes the punishment. And we're right that as a result of all these things, we should be banished. But on the cross, he takes the banishment. He takes it all. He takes it all. He takes it all. He pays the price. He then forgives us. He wipes our slate clean. He says, it's paid for. I took care of it. You're not guilty anymore. You're not responsible for that anymore. You don't have to make that right anymore. That's not being held against you anymore. I took it. It's not yours anymore. I forgive you. You are free. You are no longer guilty. You don't have to worry about measuring up anymore because I took all that stuff away. You're no longer guilty. You no longer need to stand in judgment. There is nothing to condemn you for. There is nothing to punish you for. There is nothing to banish you for. I took all of that. You're free from it. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. All that stuff on the inside that is broken as a result of the things that we have done, and as a result of the things that have been done to us, is healed. He bought that healing, and he paid that price for us. And the result of this is that Jesus came and preached peace to you who are far away and peace to you who were near. As a result of Jesus' death on the cross, his word to us is peace. You have peace with God. There is nothing that God holds against you. You are forgiven. You are clean. You are free in God's sight. God loves you. God always loved you. Even when you had messed up, even when all this stuff was counted against you, God still loved you. He never stopped loving you. And because God still loved you, he sent me. I came willingly to pay the price to remove all that stuff from your heart, to remove all that stuff from your life so that you could be free and clean and forgiven. In God's sight, there is now peace between you and God. You don't have to hide. You don't have to be afraid. He loves you. He invites you to his table. You're not. The message of Jesus to us is peace. You can have peace with yourself. Jesus says to our consciences, it's paid for. It's paid for. I have forgiven. And he says to our consciences, it's paid for. The guilt is gone. The shame is taken away. Let it go. Let it go. You don't have to hang on to it. Let it go. You don't have to condemn him. Let it go. You don't have to condemn her. Let it go. He says to our conscience, peace. You're acceptable. You're loved. You're forgiven. It's okay. And the message of Jesus to us is peace with other people. I don't have to be afraid of them. I don't have to be afraid of you. I'm not in competition with you anymore. I don't have to prove that I'm better than you. I don't have to put you down and make you worse than I. I'm loved and accepted by God because of what Jesus did. Because of what Jesus did. And because of what Jesus did, you can be too. Peace. And as Jesus preaches peace, he says to us, for through him, through Jesus, Paul says, through Jesus, we both have access to the Father by the one Spirit. Through Jesus, through his death on the cross, not through some law, not through some standard, but through Jesus' death on the cross, through Jesus paying the price for us, we have been received by God. We have access to the Father. And it is the Spirit of Jesus, the Holy Spirit, who brings us that access to God as he brings the forgiveness and the cleansing into our lives. Peace. We all have the same access to God through Jesus' death on the cross by the power of his Spirit. Is that cool? Huh? Is that cool? I get excited about this. Okay, big announcement. Drum roll here. Drum roll. You drum roll at home. Consequently, Paul writes, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household. You're not an outsider. As a result of Jesus' death, you're not an outsider. You're an insider. You belong. You measure up. All the stuff that was counted against you is gone. You measure up. And in fact, you don't have to worry about measuring up because Jesus said, I've got that. I'll take care of it. Come sit at my table. And the invitation is not only to you and to me, but to all of us who will come to Jesus and let him take care of it for us. Let him take care of the junk. Get rid of it so that we can become insiders, so that we can belong, so that we can be part of the family, so that we can be part of the membership, so that we can have a place at the table. I can sit at your table. You can sit at my table. And part of what this means is when I walk into a room, into a new group of people, I don't have to look around and wonder how I measure up against him or against her. I don't have to do that. I'm not in competition with him. I'm not in competition with her. God loves her. God loves him. God loves me. I'm not in competition. We can all sit at the table together. Yeah, how cool is that? Now, the way that all this happens, through Jesus, through his death on the cross, we access it through a prayer, a simple little prayer. Jesus, please come into my life. Please forgive me for all the stuff that I've messed up. Please take care of it. Please pay the price for it. Please send your Holy Spirit in my heart to help me live different. And as we pray that, we go from insiders, or we go from outsiders to insiders. We go from not belonging to belonging. We go from excluded from God's table to being part of God's table. And all the junk that's in our hearts is paid for. And we are free and forgiven. And we are able to recognize and receive the love for us that's always been there. And it comes to us as a gift. All we have to do is receive it. We're going to pray in a moment. I'm going to give you the opportunity to pray that prayer if you've never prayed it and to receive all of that into your life. For those of us who have prayed that prayer and have been living as belongers and insiders and have been sitting around God's table for months or years or decades, I have this invitation. Just sit and let it soak in. Oh, we hear the words here. And we know that he's done it. And sometimes we feel it here. But sometimes we don't. And sometimes we still have those doubts. Am I really loved? Am I really forgiven? Is it really okay? Am I really not in competition? Is it okay that this person seems so wonderful? And I seem wonderful, not so much. Just let it sink in that the truth is that everyone's as wonderful as everyone else. And we have been forgiven, really. And we are accepted, really. And we are loved, honestly. We're going to pray. And I want all that to sink in. Can we pray? Let's pray. Our Father, you are amazing. When we thought we were without you and the hope, you acted. And you acted in a way that we never would have in a million years believed. But you acted, and through Jesus, through his choosing to die on the cross, you have set us free from all the stuff, from all the junk. You've paid the price. Father, if there's anyone listening who has not received Jesus into their heart, please knock on the door of their heart. And if you're not sure how you are with all of this, I invite you to pray this along with me. Jesus, please come into my heart. Please forgive me for all the stuff that I've messed up. Please send your Holy Spirit to help me live different. And if you've prayed that, God is at work in your heart to do those things just now. And for the rest of us who have prayed that prayer and received that quite some time ago, let us just sit and be still. And in the silence, let wave after wave of his acceptance and his love wash over us. Let us hear his whisper. You're forgiven. It's okay. I paid for this. I love you. Have a seat at my table. Let go of all that other stuff that you think you have to overcome and measure up to. Just let it go. And let God love you. In the wonderful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. 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 Oh, we got an offering. We got announcements. Jose, could you pass the basket for us? And if you don't see Jose coming around with the basket, I got another way for you to give. If you would like to give, you can go to our website, paradisecoastchurch.org, find the Give tab, click it, and then follow the directions, and you can give that way. In terms of announcements, the schedule that we've had, our countdown to Easter speakers, Denny Dolman, the NHL hockey official who's in the Hockey Hall of Fame, going to be with us this morning, but be limited technical expertise. He's here, and we'll catch up with Denny another time. Charlie Weatherby is scheduled to be with us next week. Charlie was a college football coach for most of his career. I believe the last he coached at was the Naval Academy. Now he lives here in Naples, and he is in charge of the Ship of Christian Athletes for the Southwest Florida region. He's scheduled to be with us next week. If I can figure out how to technologically do that, he'll be with us. If not, he won't, and we'll have him with us at another time. Palm Sunday, We're going to walk through Holy Week and see what Jesus did to orchestrate his ending up on the cross. And then the week after that is Easter. Now, I don't know how all this is going to play out in terms of, are we going to be technologically together this way, or whether we'll be able to be together face to face and in person. And if you out there have technical expertise that I lack, and you can see that I lack a lot of it, please help me out. Would love to have some music as a part of this. Would love to be able to, you know, just be able to do this whole thing better. So if you're able to help me out, help me out. In terms of the things that we typically have meeting during the week, the Wednesday morning Bible study that meets at Einstein Bagels won't happen because the governor said we're not going into restaurants anymore. The Thursday night Matthew group that meets at Mike Stolke's house will continue. And we'll be here probably in this format next Sunday. Please talk to each other during the week. Call each other, text each other. As someone wrote on the internet, to all of you introverts, you're loving this. You get to stay home and be by yourself. But please, introverts, take your nose out of your books and check on your extrovert friends. They're not okay. For us who love to be face-to-face, physically contact with people, this is hard. But God will see us through. So I got a question. God in the house today, was God at work through this in your life in some way, shape, or form? If so, let me know. And if God worked in your heart through our time together, he wants to work in the heart of somebody else that you know in the same way. And I invite you to invite them to join them in our broadcast worship service next week. Okay? So, benediction. May the love of God, the grace and peace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you and be with you now and always. Amen. Amen. Thus concludes our service, and you can make your way out of the theater if we were in one. I'll be live here for a few more minutes checking the things that everybody wrote in and commented about. And if you're stopping by, have a great day. Yo, 72 comments. Wow. So we got it all going on. So those who are more technically connected than I am, if I end this live feed, will I still be able to see these comments, and will you still be able to post? And I'm assuming that my wife upstairs is hearing this, and she will come down and give me further direction. All I can say is never a teenager around when you need one. Okay, then I'm live in order to do comments. When it says Paradise Coast Church says something, that's you. Okay. Yeah, all right.
I mean, my
Okay.
I had many glitches up there where I had no idea what we were talking about because I was so far behind, and then all of a sudden it kept up and it did not be a complete sentence, so I was getting phrases and stuff.
Okay. Okay. Okay, going perfect, Tracy.
You don't need to type responses to comments, just read the comment and then let's talk.
Oh, just read the comment and talk? I can read the comment and talk?
Comment and talk because they're still hanging on.
Oh, they're still hanging on? You're all still here? Okay.
Some of them are still there. There's like 19 people that are still there.
All right. Dr. Kelly, thanks for being with us. Appreciate your presence. Brian, all the way from Connecticut, you and Bonnie, good to have you on board. Mike, thanks for being with us. Mike Stolke, and I'm going to be talking to you later and probably to your teenagers. And let's see, Sarah. Hi, Sarah. Does that mean there's a Tim there too? Joseph, good to see you. Good to have you in the house. And I'm sorry, Joseph and Patty, there's just no popcorn. Don't know how to remedy that. Okay. Hey, who else did I want to? Bruce and Carol, good to have you with us. Thanks a bunch. Look forward to connecting with you more. Patty, if I can send you popcorn, can you send me donuts? Hi, Lynn. Mike Miller, thanks for dropping by. Good to see your comments, and I assume that Liz is there with you. I saw Lizette was on online from Sarasota. That's cool. I wonder, is Shelly in the house with you, or is she off somewhere else? Carol and Cheryl, it's good to see you. Glad you made it to the broadcast. Thank you. Well, it looks to me like maybe God was in the house. So, yeah, let's see what we can do to do this again next week. Oh, Peter was there. Hi, Peter. Good to see you. Doug. Doug, all the way from Connecticut. Bless you, Doug. Thanks for being around. And Lynn, good to see you too. Another one all the way from Connecticut. Love you, Connecticut people. Come on. Anyone else to give a shout out to? Lynn, Patty. Jose, thanks for passing the basket. Thanks for helping out the bulletins. What else we got? Tracy, glad you joined us. I don't know whether you're north or whether you're here in Florida, but glad you joined us. And there's a Steve. I don't know which Steve we got, but thanks for being with us, Steve. Miss Tracy, what else I got cooking here? All right. I think I've said hello to everybody. If I didn't say hello, I'm sorry. It's my technical inexpertise. I'm going to end the video. And like I say, God bless you. Have a great day.